morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to Grindstone Island, United Methodist Church. We are blessed today to have our very own district superintendent in the house. Mark Weaver. We gather together to remind ourselves and each other that we have the enormous blessing of having each other as company on this pilgrimage of life.
Yes.
And that we're guided by this amazing source of love that sometimes we forget, that power of love to move us forward into life is the primary thing to pay attention to. And there are all kinds of different ways to engage that in every moment, in every conversation. So we just take this time to pause and try to remember that and try to put it in our heads so that through the week we can remember what is it, the high bar of love. Maybe not an easy task, but an ultimately enjoyable and fulfilling way to live. Amen?
Amen.
All right, well, let's start our worship with a little back and forth. I'll start, and you come in. You know how it is. We gather in the name of Jesus to worship God.
Surely God is in His place and calls us to worship in spirit and in truth.
God's love is poured out for you and for all people everywhere.
And we need to share God's love and life. And we may be renewed with the refreshing spirit of the living Christ.
The living Christ is with us.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Let us pray together. God, we come to you out of a sense of abundance and poverty. We have an awareness of all the gifts that are around us. And yet there are empty places inside of us. And anxieties and curiosities and uncertainties about the way ahead. So our prayer this morning is that you would remind us that all we need as we move forward in this life is the assurance that you are with us and that you are whispering to us about the way ahead and how we might engage the way ahead, and that whether we are in the midst of affliction or a celebration or just an empty feeling, that your love will prevail, and that love will lead us into the light. So thanks be to God for your gift of love. We pray it, that that gift would become enormously apparent to us this morning. And we pray it in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
All right, announcements, but let's start with mission.
Charlie.
Right, John?
That's right. You want to help me?
Sure, Charlie. You start off your list.
This church has an amazing mission, and I think every period in the summer, we support a mission. We've done the mission in Malawi, and this year we have, again, this month, we have
1,000 Islands Emergency Rescue Service. If you have any trouble and you need an emergency help, you call 911, and they work together with the fire department, so we're also going to support the fire department with our mission this month. And September will be solely for the fire department. So this is a big rock today for the Cheers Rescue Service.
And as you go around the island, you'll see these boxes with defibrillators and so on. And that's through the help of Cheers. So it's really a great service that they provide. So,
where are they?
There's one by the Red Schoolhouse. It says AED. There's one at Dutch Hall, and there's one at the winery.
And there's one at Canoe Point.
Yeah, Canoe Point. So take your CPR treatment.
And there's one at the back.
Anybody else have one?
We start with our mission because that's really our tangible expression of love for this island, for the world, and how we might, sitting here, participate with life out there. And we are convinced that God is at work through us out there, and through many, many other people out there, trying to create a beautiful world out of what might not always be such a beautiful world, which is too bad. So let's be intentional about helping God bring this beautiful thing to life. Amen.
Amen.
All right, announcements.
Yeah.
Well, let's start with Joan.
We're going to try again for Darden McQuaid at the winery Saturday night, Saturday afternoon, 4 to 6. He's going to be playing music from the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and be dancing. And that's on the house, but the drinks are not. So anyway, hopefully it will go well, because Molly last week tested positive for COVID, so keep her in our prayers.
Yes. Yeah. So
if it all goes right, otherwise you'll get a notice.
And all this is thanks to Joan for buying garden services at the Tilt fundraiser. So it kind of goes back to Tilt.
Yeah, Tilt. Absolutely.
I'd like to introduce our friends that are visiting us from Somerville, South Carolina. We have Mark and Teresa Lloyd and their son Andy, and they have been a wonderful blessing to us. We actually ended up buying their house when we moved to Somerville, and now we've become wonderful friends. They're originally from New York State, so it's been great to have them return here and be a part of our Grindstone family. So,
that's the issue. Mm-hmm. He has an insurance and he cannot work at all. So
what we raised money on site for. I think we did not do that.
Right on, right on.
Yeah, it's right here. Coffee's in the carriage house. And then there's a string pulling you right back.
Yeah.
May I be able to see the string. Well, hopefully you'll feel it. Any other things we should know about? Hopefully the voices that I've spoken will now turn into song. And we're going to stand and sing in the garden.
Thank you.
So simplicity, you know, is a virtue. You know, it's, you know, people like me and Mike spend hours looking at scripture and presenting it in a way that is understandable and immediate, and a lot of things are said in maybe complex ways or maybe simple ways, but it really is a simple undertaking, you know, this life of faith. And it really is, as T.S. Eliot once said, it's a simple matter of surrendering everything so that everything might be gained. But the thing is, it's terrifying to surrender everything. So we need help and encouragement from each other and from the Spirit of God to let go of the things that we think are so crucial and just remember that being a part of this family of love is not only what saves us from ourselves, but saves our world from the mutual destruction that we tend to want to engage. So God gives us his gift of love and trust, and our only job is to say, amen, which just means so be it. Amen.
Amen.
Special treat today. Thanks to Joan, who is our musical captain, getting us together to offer this musical offering.
God.
4, it's about Jacob wrestling. The same night Jacob got up and took his two wives, two maids, and 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. He was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him, and he passed Peniel limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the thigh muscle that is on the hip socket, because he struck Jacob on the hip socket at the thigh muscle. This is the word of God. Thank you.
Reading from John. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this, his love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Charlie said that you might want to come up and have a little time with me and Lily the dog.
big kids come too?
Yes, of course. Hi, yes. We're doing this, you know, because everybody, you want to sit down here? This is Lily. She likes to smell a little bit. And then she's looking at me. Well, I don't know. That was a long passage that Joan read beautifully. I think the point of John writing that letter to somebody was to see how many times he could use the word love and God in a couple of paragraphs. Pretty successful. But I wanted to talk a little bit about love and dogs. So Lily had a birthday about 2 weeks ago. She turned 12. And I think about all of our family, and many others are really love Lily. I'm probably with her most, so I feel a special claim to loving her the most, but that's just kind of silly talk. But when I think about a connection, like a connection with God, like Jim was reading, that no one's seen God. And so it's not a question of is God real, because if you see something that's real, like a living experience right here, that love, this connection, this feeling of being together, you don't see that, do you, either? But I tell you, that's real. And I'm sure in your family, and maybe with some friends, this warm feeling that you know you belong, even though there's nothing that you can, I mean, you can touch the people around you, and that's important to hug and to feel connected. But you know, you can feel something deep inside that means we're together. And you don't even have to say it, although it's nice to hear those words, I love you. But sometimes you just know, like Lily hasn't learned how to sing it yet. But I know it's true. And the same with God, we don't hear God say, I love you, but we can feel it. And so that's the important thing. You know, when you think about what's important in life, is to recognize the love that exists and hopefully build that out so that when you meet new people or you're in a new situation or a new classroom at school, how to create that sense of connectedness and belonging with other people. So that's really what God's all about. I don't know any other way to put it. We're going to hear Pastor Mike talk a little more about that. But let's say a little prayer, shall we? And everybody can repeat this prayer with me. And you too, if you want to. Yes. Dear God, thank you for the gift of love. And may we,
the river, which is really placid today. It's not always so grateful. We do have church conference. I won't be able to stay as long as I would like afterwards. The Moira Park United Methodist Church is officially closing as of Wednesday, and their closing service is at 5. So if you can lift them up in your prayers as they have walked down this road and So I'll be here as long as I can, but I also know that it's at least a 2-hour drive to get up there, so I want to make sure I'm not late. It always is peaceful to come here. And this is the first time I've ever been in a church where we send Neil Young as part of that. For me, that's pretty cool that everybody's at the same place, but that's all right. That's cool. I'm going to have to look that one up. Would you join me in prayer, please? Amazing and loving God, you set before us the challenge that somehow, in some way, our lives and all of their brokenness and all of our sadness and all of the possibilities you have born into us, that we could love like Jesus loves. So, oh God, as we gather, as we listen, as we worship, as we pray, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts and those tangents that you invite us on in moments just like this, may they reintroduce us to you as if for the first time, so that our hearts would be aligned with your heart. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. So probably like you, I have been really struggling. By the way, I'm Reverend Mike Wheaton. I'm the Northern Bowl District Superintendent. I probably should have started with that, which means that I have the privilege of kind of supervising, if that's the right word, ministry of pastors and churches from Pulaski to Chattahoochee. And if you know New York State, that's not a small amount of territory, but it's a great privilege. This is God's country. I remind, when we have our annual meeting, I remind the conference every year, I'm appointed to God's country. Of course, I have other colleagues that will disagree with me on that. I've been wrestling like you with the reality of the increasing polarization, which is a part of our culture and part of our politics, and the way in which we so easily allow and divide ourselves into camps, whether it's politics, whether it's social issues, whether it's whatever the issues are. I'm really struck by how easily we allow that to happen, how reinforced that comes. And I find myself asking the question, challenging myself, you know, when will we really start talking not to one another, but with each other? I mean, what does it mean for us to love people more than positions? And so I've been thinking a lot about love lately, and because, as Jeff reminded me, John tried to stick as many references to love as John could in this letter. I read this chapter, and something jumped out at me, which is a little bit uncomfortable, because the writer of the letter says that if we can't love our brothers and sisters who we can see, literally it says we cannot love God who we cannot see. Now that cannot is a big word, and it takes up a lot of space. It feels like there's no room for light, there's no room for negotiation. That's the way it is. If we can't love people who we can't see, then we cannot love God who we can't see. That is a high bar. Really high bar. I remember when I was a sophomore in high school, I went out for the track team, and because I was a little bit tall and I played basketball, they probably thought I had jumping abilities. Ha ha ha. So they assigned me to the high jump. And, you know, I could get 5'8". You know, but to get to 5'9", 5'10", which is really not that high when you look at the Olympics, but it was my challenge, you know, to get to 5'9" and 5'10" was a really high bar. You know, I could look at it, and literally I could see it, and it was a high bar to meet. But I discovered that as I began to work with the coaches, and they began to help me unlearn some habits, and to learn some new habits, how I am making steps up to the bar, how I'm using my arms, some leg strengthening exercises, I began to get better. And I did make it to 5:10. But I just couldn't get above that. But you know, I got better and I learned something which continues to speak to me and maybe to all of us in our lives that, you know, to be perfected in my ability to be a high jumper, to reach that high bar required a lot of practice and a lot of hard work. Sometimes I had to let go of some habits and learn new ones. And sometimes I felt like I was taking two steps forward and one step back. And then I read this text again, and it says, if we can't love the people we can see, then we cannot love God who we cannot see. Man, how can we reach that bar? And like all high bars of God's truth, you know, if your life is like, man, one of my desires, man, I just want to love like Jesus. You know, I just want to, in all of my humanness, be like Jesus, to grow in that Christ-likeness. But, you know, it's pretty hard to do that. It's pretty hard to say we love God if we find that we cannot love those nearest to us, even love those who are different than us. And my friends, if we can't love here and extend that out to wherever your community is, if we can't love here, how can we say our hearts long to be aligned with God's heart? Now, if your life is like mine, I recognize that we're not all that we want to be. I am not all I want to be. And I am as capable of being influenced by media narratives, by what I'm reading, what I'm hearing, the people who I want to like and who I want to be liked by. But the reality is, there are influences that distract us. There are influences that sometimes pull us down and oftentimes will misshape our love. We can reach that high bar. That's part of what this text that Joan read. And by the way, Betty, that was a beautiful reading of the Genesis passage. Thank you. We can reach that high bar because in verse 15 of the passage that Joan read, the writer of John says that God abides in those who confess that Christ is the Son of God and they abide in God. Because if something special happens with us when we become aware of just how unique and life-giving this awareness of who Jesus is, something happens to us, and something happens inside of us. In John, the very first chapter of his gospel, in verse 12, John writes that those who believed in him, he gave power to become children of God. Something from outside of us that does something inside of us. And in that awareness comes this renewal of purpose, this reshifting of direction, this compulsion to be compelled by love that will not let us go. And the powerful part is all of that is poured out not just for us, for the sake of the world. Boy, if your life is like mine and you watch the news and read my pad, the world needs more of that love that God has empowered us with. And we can also get there. Look at verse 12. If you have a chance to look at it, the writer says, no one has seen God, but I love this, if we love one another. If we love one another, God abides in us. And I like this. His love is perfected in us. In other words, it feels to me like what the writer is saying, keep loving, man. Keep striving for that high bar. Keep trying to love even the people you know that you probably don't like so much, because somehow in that loving, there is something about the love of God that abides more deeply and richer inside of us. He uses that word perfected, which to me means we haven't arrived. Perfected means it's an ongoing morphing them, shaping them. And the daily practice of loving is hard work, isn't it? It requires changing, not unlike me learning how to high jump. There's things I had to change, there are habits I had to let go, and there are new habits I needed to focus on. We can be perfected in love. Wesley used to say we're going on to perfection, and those who study him will tell you he really meant we become perfect after this life, but he says in this life, the Spirit of God is always at work. Maybe getting our attention and oftentimes molding us. I had a conversation with someone this week as I was sharing with him about loving and this passage and kind of where I wanted to go with it. And he kind of stopped me up in my reflection as I thought about reaching that high bar and what really being perfect in love could look like. And he said, Mike, I grew up with two older brothers who traumatized me as a child. He said, and I hear you talk about this, and I gotta be honest with you, Mike, I have a hard time loving them. They have both passed away. So he doesn't have the opportunity to maybe find reconciliation. And he caught me up in that conversation. And I think, I don't wanna say that there are grades of love, but I think there are layers of love. And as we talked about his experience and the trauma he felt and his inability to love his brothers, I said, maybe your first step is not to love your brothers, but to find a place and a way to forgive them. Maybe that's the most loving you can do until God enables you to go to the next step. And he said, I'll have to pray about that. Because there needs to be justice, there needs to be some admission of guilt, some authentic seeking of forgiveness, but in a situation like his, that kind of loving has got to be hard. But there's something about forgiving, you know, that phrase that when we forgive, we set the prisoner free and discover that the prisoner is us. Because oftentimes we're the ones that are carrying the pain and the harm so deeply that maybe sometimes we become too comfortable with it. And we're still being harmed by something that happened a long time ago. Because at the heart of it, my friends, to love another person, at the heart of what I'm saying is to live our lives in a way which imitates the love of Jesus, which was sacrificial love. Love sacrificially. To love that considers others first, to love that looks for the best in other people, to love in a way that shows respect, that seeks unity, to love that is unselfish, to love that offers others your best, to love to displace patience. If your life is like mine, it's hard work. It's like me having to learn every day of the high jump practice. Techniques. It's hard work to replace the certainty of my position with a greater curiosity and wonder about where that other person really is coming from. And be curious. Not to assert my own place, but instead to find a place where we maybe could meet together. Or to replace my desire to label others as different than me, or to label others in a particular camp or that hold a particular position, then instead to replace that with a desire to step back and replace that with respect. That's how I work. But that's how we are perfected in love. And here's the thing that I love being reminded when I come here. And I think Jeff says it probably every time I've come here in a different way. We need each other for this work. We need each other for this work because it is hard work, because we are all influenced by narratives and media and opinions and perspectives, and we can get caught up in that. And in the environment and in the gathering together to hear our stories, to share our positions, to try to love one another, even though we may be different to one another, we begin to learn and we begin to grow. And actually, I think what happens to me is I find out what some of the things getting in my way of loving my brothers and sisters. John Wesley, if you know anything about him, he started the Methodist movement and used to gather his first followers in classes of 12 people and bands of 5 or 6 people. Because I think he knew that in order for love to grow requires accountability of relationship and one another to maybe call us up when we fall short and maybe to walk alongside us when we fall short, to help support us, encourage us, to be honest with us, and ultimately to love us, even in those moments when we don't seem that lovable. We need each other for this work. That's how God's love is perfected in us. And isn't that our goal? To be more, to love more like Jesus, than to be more like someone else. To care for people, not positions. I had an interesting experience. I'm grateful for the health care that I receive, and one of the things I'm privileged to do every year is go to some location and have my blood drawn so they can tell me how good or bad my numbers are and how much weight I need to lose and all that good stuff. And so I went to one of these diagnostic places, had my blood drawn, and the tech, you know, she's sitting there drawing my blood, and she asked me what I do for a living. I said, well, I'm a pastor. And it kind of piqued her curiosity and her interest. She said, oh, really? Where do you serve? And I said, well, I live in Gouverneur. She knew where Gouverneur is. This was in Syracuse, by the way. That's why I said it. Because a lot of the times I don't get the answer. Really, where is that? Is that in Canada? Some people say it is. So then she started to ask me about what I do, the minister, and then she said, you know, I started to read my Bible, she said, but it seems like in the last few weeks, I've fallen off. And so I asked her more about that, and as we talked a little bit, I asked her, are you worshiping somewhere with everybody? And she grew quiet. And then she said, can I call you Mike? I said, sure. She said, Mike, I had a DUI about 10 years ago. And she said, when I've gone places to worship, the feeling I got from people were one of two. One was, if I wasn't wearing the right clothes, then I wasn't welcome. She said, the other thing that would happen is when I would get to know people and they would ask me about my past and I told them about my DUI, she said, it almost felt like someone put a cold wall between me and them. Man, that bothers me. And I walked out of that engagement. We prayed a little bit, actually, before she left, before I left. And as I walked, I asked myself, you know, here's a woman looking for direction, looking for God, ultimately, I think, looking for the fullest expression of love. And she feels turned away by the church. Not you, but the big church that we're all a part of. And I kept asking myself, why do we miss those opportunities to be love and to be perfected in love? Because what John says is, you got to keep loving to be perfected in love. And what would it mean for us to be a church that cares far more for people than we do for positions? And so here's my challenge, and I don't know if you're going to do this next week, but you can do it next week, I encourage you every day this week, try to remember what I shared with you just now, and invite God in a morning prayer to say, God, show me how I can be love to someone I see today. Show me where. And maybe next week, as part of your worship, you can trade stories. Because you and I both know this world needs a whole lot more. thank you for being the body of Christ. Thank you for the way you welcome me, and I know where your heart is. Let us continue to be a church that cares more for people than we do for traditions. And all that people say.
Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
sister Meg contacted me earlier this week to say a tragedy that happened in her husband's family. A father whose kid had just given birth, and the baby was born beautifully and healthy, and the next day, so the kid's grandfather took his life. And so that family is just reeling with, you know, that, yes. Lord, in your mercy. Sorry to lay that on you like that.
Prayers for Jim Cuppernall.
Jim Cuppernall, yes. Thank you, David, for helping us support Jim. Lord, in your mercy. Inform our struggle. Keep us hopeful. Let us know that your light is all around us, and your love is available to us at every moment to give us that strength. So be with us. Shelter us and give us courage. We pray all these various things of joy and of hope. Challenge in the strong name of Jesus our Lord, who gave us the gift of this prayer, saying, Our Father,
Lord our God, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
affirming God's presence and God's love by the giving of our gifts. Let's continue with our honor. And I'm pleased to say that Jeremy Taylor has an original
Thank you.
our ways. God in Christ has come to stay and live tomorrow's life today. So let's get out there and do that.
Yeah.
Coffee, conference.
Yeah.